I am committed to dealing with our pension issues in ways that are fiscally responsible and respectful toward the needs of our public employees. And unlike some others involved in this race, I am committed to running my campaign in an honest and positive way, focusing on issues and not on innuendo. We need a new voice with credentials and experience to confront our challenges thoughtfully and decisively. I am prepared to be that new voice, and I ask all of you to support me in that effort. Bingo.
Well done. Mr. Egger, you're next.
Well, thank you, Peter.
Hold on one second.
No, we'll give an extra green.
Okay, thanks, Rob.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Peter, and I can attest to Peter's ability to do great operations. He was my orthopedic surgeon a number of years ago on my knee, and that he still works great, so good job, Peter. I've lived and worked in Deerbrook for a long time, 40 years in around Wright County. I used to drive a red truck. And, I served all the stores through here, from Woodlands Market to Molly Stokes. It was Petrini's back in the day. local restaurants, everywhere from the Golden Gate Bridge to Nevada. And I met so many people in these communities. I even ran a Red Mountain in West Marin. It was just a fabulous way to earn a living and meet people, be part of the community. I was elected to Fairfax Town Council a number of years ago. I served 7 terms as mayor. I was California's first Prop 20 Coastal Commissioner and served for 9 years, so I was reappointed under the Coastal Act of 1976. So I bring an environmental edge to the position here in Marin County. For so long, Marin County was at the forefront of environmental issues statewide. Folks all over the state, there's 58 counties in California, and they looked at Marin County as the county that was most respected and most far ahead of its time on environmental issues. So I'll ask that it take part. If I'm elected, Marin will join Mendocino, Santa Cruz, San Benito, and now hopefully Monterey counties that ban fracking. And folks say, oh, there's no problem with fracking in Marin. Well, we could be diagonally being fracked from Contra Costa County right now. We have no idea. We have no idea what's going on. We need a complete ban. We also need a ban on the use of pesticides in the county unincorporated commons. You know, it's nice to talk about we're not going to use this kind of pesticide or that kind of pesticide, or we're not going to have it on this part, but maybe over here in this open space, if Frank's elected, it's no, zero pesticide use, period. We don't need to use pesticides here. We're not at a crossroads. So the question is Marin County, are things going to change at the Civic Center, or is it going to be business as usual? I'm not about change, I'm about positive change, making our towns and communities better. You know, if you look at Marin Pacific Center, once a year they come out with the best of Marin, and you'll see Fairfax is one of the best towns in Marin. It is the best town, number one. And so it took a lot of work to keep it that way. We had an onslaught of development and just trying to develop the town, and we've always kept it down pretty much. It's a sweet little community, just as here we are in Ross and Kentfield and Green Bay, the Larchburg, sweet little communities, and we need to protect that ambiance, that small town character. So if you like me, I'll be right there with you. I'll be representing you. I won't represent this management of the county staff, and I won't be representing the consultants. Thank you.
Thanks, Greg.
No, I think what she's saying is if the mics were pulled a little bit away from
away.
The speaker,
so
we can hear it better.
Kind of garbled. Yeah.
Probably can I get back 2 minutes over, 3 minutes over?
No, Frank, you can't.
So I'd like to go to the questions right away.
Before we get started, anybody that has filled out a card or would like those questions brought to the front, if you can pass them to either aisle there, stop now, collect them, and every now and then we'll bring them off the computer. So thank you, Michael.
Sure. So, anybody have a question?
I have a question. So, in Marin and everywhere else, there is a tendency of folks who have a particular issue to make donations to the campaigns of people who serve on boards. So my question is, if you accept campaign donations from a party who stands to benefit from a board of supervisors' decision, do you recuse yourself from such votes? And also, under what circumstances would you decline a campaign contribution?
So, I think Les will go in the same order. And I don't think you're going to need 3 minutes to answer that question, so brevity would be appreciated.
No, that's like a 10-second answer.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Sir, okay. So I have received in this campaign re-election cycle contributions from literally hundreds of people in Marin County, most of them in District 2. And had the same experience in my first election, my first campaign. And you know what it comes down to is this is a small county. And if every elected official were to recuse themselves from making a decision or voting on an issue that may involve somebody who'd made a contribution, you'd have, you'd be recusing yourself constantly. I think what the voters of Marin want, and the residents of Marin County want, and most places want, are people serving who are people of integrity. And I can tell you that I have received contributions from all sorts of folks who have had issues that have come before the board, and I have not voted in their favor. And I am always honest and open when I receive a contribution that people know that they're not buying my vote. So I think, and I'm trying to think of, I would not accept a contribution, frankly, if there was a pending issue and it was, an unwarrantedly too generous of a campaign contribution. I haven't bumped into that yet, but I do think about things like that during the course of the campaign.
Thank you.
Jeff.
Byron.
Thank you. Well, I appreciate Supervisor Rice's answer to that question, but I find it a little challenging to understand exactly what was being said right now. Because we know, just for looking at the records that have been submitted to the state of to Sacramento, the state of California, on campaign contributions, that Supervisor Rice has received contributions from a variety of different sources with issues pending before the Board of Supervisors right now. Including contributions from consultants and engineering firms that are very actively involved, for example, in the flood control project that we're supposedly undertaking right now. So that seemed to me to be a little disingenuous. But I want to answer your question. I am a lawyer. I have practiced law for 35 years. Conflicts of interest are one of the most important things that I, as a lawyer, have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. And I take those potential conflicts very, very seriously. In my legal practice, whenever there is even the appearance of a potential conflict of interest arising from a prospective client engagement, we step back. We do not engage on that basis. We turn down cases and matters all the time because of the perceived or actual conflict of interest arising from matters that we are asked to handle. So to answer your question, Amy, I will not allow myself to be in a position where I have to decide on matters where there are contributions that are being made to my campaign, to my interests, where that conflict of interest will exist. I will recuse myself relentlessly under circumstances where that is a problem. Thank so it's an easy thing for me to answer. Thank you.
Greg, that's the answer.
That's really a great question because it goes to the heart of the matter of what's going on here in Marin County. You just follow the money, as you'll say, follow the money in politics, and you're gonna see what happens, what's gonna happen down the road. I'll be out, spent about 10 to 1 by opponents, and we don't raise big money. I have sent $1,000 checks back. As I refuse to accept the money. So thank you very much for your kind offer, but unfortunately I see a potential conflict of interest down the road, and I send a check back with a note. I've received no special interest money. I've received no political action committee money from either a union or from a corporation, and I won't. So I will not be running those kinds of conflicts of interest. I do receive contributions from individuals, and if in fact one of the individuals that contributes to my campaign comes before me at a future date, then I would recuse myself if in fact, you know, it was an appearance of conflict of interest. I've always been very conscious of conflict of interest issues, especially as an elected official for the past 45 years in Marin County. So I'm with you right there on that question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to take the moderator's privilege and sort of choose some of these questions. I know that traffic is a big issue in the polls where people are polled and say, what's the biggest issue facing our county? And traffic is one of them. And so this question is, it can take 30 minutes to drive from Kent Middle School to Highway 101 on weekday mornings with no traffic. In the middle of the night, it's 10 minutes. What will you do to enhance traffic flow to make that trip quicker? And I have to say, there was a meeting, a public meeting on traffic, where traffic consultants came in and discussed calming the traffic, which I found to be a somewhat upsetting phrase. It sounded like it wasn't actually going to be traffic. But anyway, I wonder if you could answer that.
Do you want to do it the same word as constantly?
You want to switch it?
We can switch.
You want to
go first? It's
fine.
Okay.
You go first.
That's how they go.
Yeah. The risk of that is that I'll say something and they'll come back.
I know, and then you won't be able to back on.
I always prefer to go last, but that's okay. This is a big issue for me. I have been engaged on the traffic issues in Marin County now for ever, it seems like. And partly because I am a recipient of the traffic congestion problems that we face every day. I have to get up in the morning, I have to take my daughter to school at Kent. I have to now figure out how to take my daughter to school at Redwood next year, because God bless her, she's now going to graduate from middle school and go on to that. And then my wife and I have to go to work in the morning. We have to face the traffic problems that we confront on a day-to-day basis. We work, we take our kids to school, it's a challenge for us in our day-to-day lives. So I've watched the process that the county has gone through in trying to address traffic congestion problems on the stretch of Sir Francis Drake between Ross and 101. That is the most congested traffic problem that we have in Marin County. The county has gone through this kind of endless iteration of options. They have $13 million that they've been allocated to spend on dealing with traffic congestion problems in that quarter. They've said, well, we really don't need that much money. We only need $6 million to deal with road rehabilitation aspects of it. So we have $6 million to play with. So they've been playing with it. They've been proposing different options that can accommodate special interests throughout the community. Bicycle lanes, expanded pedestrian lanes, traffic calming measures, reconfiguring intersections. None of that makes any sense. I have been a strident advocate of two things to deal with the traffic congestion problems that we have on 101, or I'm sorry, on Sir Francis Drake leading to 101. Pave the streets, reconfigure the lanes, and apply adaptive signal control technologies, which are control technologies that will actually allow signals to be monitored and modified in a way that will allow traffic to flow in a reasonable way through the corridor onto 101. That may not deal with all the traffic problems 100% during the course of the day. When there's gridlock on St. Francis Drake, there's going to be gridlock. But 90% of the time during the course of the day, having a computerized real-time traffic control technology to manage traffic flowing through that corridor will actually create tremendous benefits for all of our community on a long-term basis. There are other issues we have to deal with in terms of the Greenbrae Interchange, the 580 northbound ramp onto 580 from 101. Those are things that we need to address as well. But the biggest problem is traffic congestion on St. Francis Drake in this corridor. There are easy solutions to deal with it. It's within our budget, and we ought to implement them and not be distracted by proposals to do other things to take money away from what's allocated for that project. Thank you.
Finished right on time. Frank?
Sure. So traffic. It's not like it's just happened. It's been occurring all along, and the proposal to reduce the traffic lanes on Sir Francis Drake down to 11 feet, it's just going to make things worse. Traffic calming in certain circumstances works, but it's not going to work here on Sir Francis Drake. We're trying to move folks through the corridor here. Ross and Marksburg need to be integral part of this whole traffic congestion solution, because they are the cities on the opposite ends here, and they need to be part of it. Quite often, we said, we have the county making these decisions, thinking that they know better for all of us, but let me tell you, when there's, when 72% of the population lives in incorporated city, we in the cities need to have our say as to how we're gonna end up, and Ross's in Washington need to be part of it. As far as what else is going on, one lane going southbound on 101 at the end of Drake, and one lane going under the freeway is totally insufficient. We need two lanes southbound, we need two lanes going under. And we've got to get both, we're gonna keep the three lanes open on both directions. On the Richmond Santa Fe, it's not just one direction. If we continue to improve high density in the upper end, like they tried Fairfax, you know, 2 years ago, we had to run a referendum to stop 300 units from being built in the upper Rossville. That would have put a tremendous traffic load here in the lower Rossville, in central lower Ross Valley. So we did that by using a ballot measure, and I think it's important that the folks understand that they have that opportunity, initiative and referendum, and we don't see enough of them here. And I think ballot box zoning actually works, and the people's right to take an issue before their voters works too. I think it's important that be done. But anyway, back to the traffic. What we've got, we're in General Hospital, it's a trauma center. We've got emergency vehicles running in and out of here all the time. If we lower that, if we reduce the traffic lanes to 11 feet, it's gonna make it actually dangerous when we're getting emergency equipment in and out of this, in and out of our valley here. So that's no solution. Traffic signals should, of course, they should be synchronized. You know, we keep talking about the upper Ross, so we're gonna synchronize the traffic signals. They've been talking about it for, I don't know, 10 years. They're still not synchronized, so that may not be the ultimate solution. But the fact is, you'll say this, when you find yourself in a hole, quit digging. So, you know, we've got to look at the kind of density that's coming along in our communities, and because we should be generating more traffic. We have enough problems dealing with our existing traffic. Thank you.
Very good. Finished ahead of time. We'll give you an extra minute, Mr. Rice.
I'll stick on the three. So I think the way we address traffic on the Sir Francis Drake corridor is the way we have to address it in other highly congested corridors, and that's through one, dealing with school-related traffic. That is a cohort that's on the roads during the commute time that makes an enormous impact negatively on our roadways and ties things up, and we all know that. We experience that because when schools are out of session, like during Easter break, we see the difference. So we need to address school-related traffic. I've been working with Kent Middle School and the Kent School District this past year, and getting them set up to hopefully start a yellow bus pilot for Kent School, mostly basic school students probably coming from Green Gray, either this coming fall or the following fall. We've started a similar pilot up in the upper Ross Valley serving White Hill Middle School. There's 500 kids that are taking the bus to White Hill Middle School along Sir Francis Drake Corridor every day. That's reducing car trips by 2,000 trips over the course of the day. So school-related traffic has to be addressed, and I'm working on that and making good progress. Second, the Sir Francis Drake Corridor project is all about making that roadway work more efficiently for auto traffic during the highly congested times. The improvements at the intersections that allow for shorter signal times, signal cycle times, between adding a third lane eastbound as you get in front of Bonnier and heading to the freeway, and some other improvements in intersections, plus this adaptive signal technology that Kevin and Frank are talking about, will make a big difference for Sir Francis Drake. They will not solve the problem when we're at total gridlock, but for the bulk of the time when things are just crowded, we will see a big improvement. Third, we do need to address what's happening on East Sir Francis Drake. This project that goes from Ross, the one I'm talking about that goes from Ross to the freeway, needs to tie into East Sir Francis Drake in order to make things flow better. And I'm working on getting that segment of the project done online and funded as a phase two. And we also have to address the 101 and 580 exchange or interchange up in San Rafael, so that traffic's moving more smoothly. That will keep people getting onto the Richmond Santa Fe Bridge, moving through that Green Gray interchange, and allow Sir Francis Drake to work. And then fourth, I just want to say something about process on the Sir Francis Drake Corridor project. We talk all the time about needing to open up the public process and the design projects to bring more public in, make the process more transparent, listen to the voices of the community. That's exactly what the Sir Francis Drake Corridor Improvement Project has been about. I am telling the engineers, take the time to work with the community, take the time to go meet on site, take the time to get input on this project so we can make it the best it can be.
Since Supervisor Rice mentioned my name in her response to me.
No, we're not going to do that.
Right, well, I tried.
Nice try.
I tried.
The next question is actually two people asked the same question, so I'm going to sort of combine them and let Frank go first to discuss it, because he actually referred to it in his previous remarks. So one question is, do you agree we need to protect Eastern Marin, the area the county calls the city center corridor, from overdevelopment? If so, how do you propose to protect it? And the second question is similar. It says, as supervisor, do you promote or oppose high-density housing and transit-oriented development? So, Frank, there you go.
Sure. So I was part of the original countywide plan a long time, how long ago, but it was 1972. And when we developed the plan, there was the coastal corridor, the inland rural corridor, and the east urbanized corridor. At no time did we ever think that 30 units per acre was going to be the norm for the eastern urbanized corridor. So that's come about as a result of Plan Bay Area and the Association of Bay Area Governments and the Marin Metropolitan Transportation Commission and the Housing and Community Development Agency of the state, which is of course trying to get more housing in the Bay Area. For instance, the San Quentin Vision Plan would allow 2,000 to 3,000 units built up on San Quentin. Once the prison closes, folks say the prison will never close. Well, there's two initiatives pending. Neither one have qualified yet, but they're trying to qualify for the November ballot. Both are constitutional amendments, and both will end San Quentin State Prison as the death row for the state of California. Once that happens, death row inmates will no longer be housed in San Quentin. Once that happens, that is the most expensive, almost the most expensive prison for the state to run, and the state will close that down. So they're going to be looking at what Marin has in mind for the San Quentin Peninsula. And unfortunately, the Board of Supervisors has in mind the San Quentin Vision Plan, 2,000 to 3,000 units right down here, right down the road. That's the largest sphere of influence, and no way should Marin have approved the San Quentin Vision Plan. We appeared at the Board of Supervisors meeting about 2 years ago when Supervisor Kinsey was trying to have a designated also priority development area, and we were able to stop that. So that's just one issue with high density development. As far as a priority development area, what happens is when a city or a county approves the designation, it in fact gives the developer a leg up on what's going to happen in that area on that land. And we don't have to become San Jose North in order to have affordable housing in Marin. We've done a good job in Fairfax, and we don't need to make our communities look like Walnut Creek or some other place in order to have affordable housing. So, it's going to be dependent on the supervisors that you elect. And if you elect me, you're going to have a supervisor that's answers to you. I don't answer to the consultants, I don't answer to the staff, I answer to you. My home phone number is on all the material, my campaign material. I'm old school. I don't screen calls. You call my number, I pick it up and say hello. And so that's what I think being elected official and a representative official is all about. And let me in, and I'll be there for you. Thank you.
So the city center corridor, as Frank mentioned, was part of the real visionary land use planning that took place in the early 70s, the establishment of the city center corridor, the inland rural, and then our agricultural zone in the west. We added to that the bay lands corridor. And then what it was all about was preventing sprawl and looking forward into the future of this county towards trying to protect our existing cities and community character, and for preventing sprawl out into our ag lands, protecting that important industry and that important way of life that so much defines Marin out in West Marin. And the city center corridor, I would say at this point, just like the Ross Valley, is pretty much built out. I can think of one green space specifically that still is zoned, has a zoning for development. That would be St. Vincent Silvera. And I would say that there's many in this community, including myself, who would like to continue to see that be green space. It was downzoned many years ago to just 221 units total. But what happens there remains to be seen. But otherwise, we have done a good job sticking to the land use plan that said, let's not sprawl. Ross Valley, the Ross Valley in particular, District 2 in particular, as I said before, is pretty much built out. But very few opportunities, vacant pieces of land or underdeveloped land are few and far between, and frankly, will have to be, will be scrutinized if any proposals come forward. I have confidence in the protections that have been put in place by our land use plan, by the Kentfield Greenbrae Community Plan, by our development code, that we are going to remain consistent with anything that gets developed. The community will not stand for something that does not fit within the community's character. And then with regards to transit-oriented development, again, with so few opportunities, the very few opportunities that are there to develop generally tend to be on our transit corridors where there is public transit. And I do think it makes sense that if there is development made places, it is made close to where people can get on transit, and we're not, inducing sprawl. So that's what I have on that.
So if you have a little bit of time left,
and I'm fine.
I thought maybe you could comment on your views on the development at WinCup.
Oh, WinCup. Well, that was a monster of a mistake that was made by the city of Corte Madera, and is the poster child for what we don't like to see happen in this county and in our communities, which is basically a project that was approved. Design approved through the environmental review process as they went through their general plan, and it didn't involve. Well, he asked me a question. Okay.
No, go ahead. You give her a few more grades.
Anyway, that is not a kind of project that I would have ever supported. I think many of us did not see that coming. It was zoned for, planned for, and approved through their general plan process during the height of the recession. We were not as worried about traffic then. Corte Madera residents didn't seem to speak up about it. And I think the silver lining is it made a whole lot of people start paying attention to what happens around land use and development in Marin County.
Thank you very much. Kevin?
Well, I'm going to ask for an extra minute.
Okay. You can ask.
I'm sure I won't get it, but that's the way it goes. First of all, I have to go back because I did ask for a moment to respond to what Supervisor Rice said about traffic on the transit straight and the implementation of adaptive traffic signal control technology. That is not part of the plan that the county has put forth. The only thing that the county has said about that is that they would allow for the construction of conduits that would allow for fiber optics cabling to accommodate that in the future. But as part of what they're proposing to do now, there is nothing that will allow for computerized traffic control technology in the plan that exists right now. So that was not an accurate statement. I appreciate what Mr. Egger had to say. I have to also call into question Supervisor Rice's comments about encouraging development, high-density development along the 101 corridor. I've been engaged in the several iterations of the housing element of the countywide plan for the last 2 years, and each time the county has endorsed high-density development in greenfield spaces, including St. Vincent Silvera Ranch, the Grady Ranch, a variety of different properties, all up and down 101. That is part of what the county, with Supervisor Rice's approval and endorsement, has been proposing for the last couple of years. I have relentlessly opposed that. I've sued the county over the adoption of their housing element 2 years ago because of the failure for the county to adequately evaluate the environmental impacts of exactly the kind of development Supervisor Rice just disown. It's not accurate and it's not true. The reason I got into this race, into this campaign, was because the work that I did 2 years ago on the Larkspur Station Area Plan, which is a proposal to do exactly the kind of high-density development that the county board of supervisors for the last several years has been relentlessly supporting. I have opposed it. I voted against it. I articulated reasons why it shouldn't occur and it should not occur. We cannot allow the county board of supervisors to continue on a path to increase transit-oriented development along the 101 corridor because it makes no sense for the character of the communities in which we live. Transit-oriented development does not make sense in Marin County. It may make sense in Mountain View. It may make sense in San Jose. It may make sense in Oakland. But our county is distinct. I am very proud of the efforts that I have been engaged in over the last several years on climate change within this county. The most important thing that the county itself has recognized that will address our impacts for global warming and climate change is to enhance the ability of our community to exploit opportunities for renewable energy resources and the development of those resources within our county, not transit-oriented development.
Very good. Thank you for finishing on time. There are a couple of additional questions which are related to this traffic issue because the traffic relates to the development, the high-density development, and each make each other worse. And there are a couple of related questions. One is, what is your position on the smart train, which will have a large effect on traffic, from what I've heard, because as the train comes into San Rafael, the traffic stops, and people bored with that come down to Sir Francis Drake. So the problems are sort of multiplying on top of each other. And I think that if we could combine those two questions, we could maybe do a short addition to the that we've already covered. That's all right.
What was
I have to wake him up.
What was the
question is, the smart, in with relation to traffic and the smart train, should the smart train be extended to Larkspur Landing is a specific question. Okay. And then, you know, do you support the idea in general? So, you're up.
So I think that whoever asked the question, or if it was you, Peter, is right. The particularly phase two of the smart train, the segment front that will go from San Rafael to Larkspur, has the potential to really be disruptive to east-west traffic flow through San Rafael during the construction phase. And if we don't have a good plan for how the Bettini Center is reconfigured to deal with the transit, the transit hub that it is, we're going to have pretty much of a mess, I think, downtown. So I've been advocating, actually, for a little bit of a pause on that phase two of the smart train to Larkspur until we actually know we have a good plan, a permanent plan, for how that area, 2nd and 3rd Street, and where the smart train comes through, is going to actually operate. So that we don't end up with gridlock on a daily and maybe three times an hour basis in San Rafael. I was not a supporter of the smart train, the plan when it was first proposed, and mostly because I looked at the numbers on how many passengers were going to be carried riding the train, given the limited number of cars, the limited frequency of the train. On the other hand, I saw that it was going to be a benefit to have that infrastructure in place. I also did like the fact that it was going to include the bike, parallel bike infrastructure. That said, the proposal passed, and now I want to see SMART be successful, that phase one particularly. I think it's going to be a great transit option for people who can ride it. And I'd like to see it be a success.
What about the fact that when the train comes into San Rafael, the gates go down and the traffic is stopped?
Yeah, so that will be, I think there's going to be some hiccups there, but they actually, in my understanding, those lights and those gates are the time. They have some of this more next generation technology that allows for better synchronization, but I think it is going to be disruptive.
Point of information, Peter.
Yes.
The plans are that when the gate is down, excuse me, when the signal is red, rather, the, when the gates are down, the signals will be red, and so that there will be no additional red time that would be stopping traffic. So the whole idea, yes, it's part of the issue. It takes less time for the train to pass through the intersection and for the gates to go up than it takes for the red light to change.
So the train will not stop at an intersection, but...
Hell no. That's part of the plan. So I just thought it was important that that factual basis be present.
Yeah. And it's important that we believe that that's going to be the case. But I voted for the smart train. I was a dummy. And Kevin, you're up.
I didn't vote for the smart train. No, that's not true. That's not true. But I did not vote for the smart train. I never thought it was a good idea. And I don't believe for a minute the predictions that the administrators running SMART have made about the impacts of SMART on our community. I have been amazed by what I have heard and seen about the predictions for ridership on SMART, for example. And the way in which SMART has conducted its grant access process, they have not been straightforward and honest with federal government or the state government in terms of their predictions for ridership. They base their predictions on capacity of those trains, not on actual studies for what the ridership will be. So we've basically been sold a bill of goods with SMART all the way along. I don't believe for a minute that the ridership is going to be there. I don't believe for a minute that the impacts on traffic in San Rafael will be what was just described. I think it's going to be entirely disruptive. We won't know until it actually happens, and unfortunately we're going to have the opportunity to see that because SMART is coming. We're stuck with it. It's a bad idea, but it is coming. As far as the extension of SMART to the city of Lawrenceburg, it's always been my view that that should not happen unless and until we see true ridership statistics that will demonstrate that there's actually a need for bringing SMART into the city of Lawrenceburg, into the Lawrenceburg landing. When you actually think about the configuration of that facility, it makes absolutely no sense. I thought that SMART was being sold to voters as a basis for bringing commuters into Lawrenceburg Landing so they could access the ferry terminal there and go on to work in other parts of our community. There is no plan that the SMART folks have put together. SMART folks, that's a not expression. There is no reasonable plan to actually transport people from where the SMART train would end up behind the Century Theater in Lawrenceburg Landing to get across the Francis Drake and off the ferry building. There is absolutely no logistical sense to the configuration that the SMART administration has put together in order to accommodate commute traffic that would be coming down from the north into Lawrenceburg Landing. So I think it's a mistake. Obviously, there are others who have different views. So if SMART is going to come, I would like to actually see hard quantitative data that demonstrates that, in fact, that is a viable resource that we would have for our community that would enhance the quality of life in our community. I don't believe for a minute that it will. I don't think statistics will ever show that. I don't believe the case that the administrators at SMART have made that we won't have traffic congestion problems in San Rafael. I think it's actually a disaster waiting to happen. But thanks to our county board of supervisors and others that have supported SMART all along, we're going to have to deal with it. And I hope it's all good luck.
Thank you.
Frank, weren't we on a committee together where they talked about SMART?
We were.
What a great idea.
How long ago was that, Peter? What, 25 years or
five?
don't put dates out there. We're going to date ourselves if we start talking about the good old days now.
Come on. Tough to get a date anyway.
So my grandparents used to travel by ferry from San Francisco. We're a San Francisco family. We've been in the city since the turn of the century. They traveled by ferry to Marin and by train on up through Fairfax, on out to West Marin, west of Noble County, on into Casadero. Today we own Casadero Winery. Renee and I were a small boutique winery. This one, 31 gold and silver medals in 4 years on the market, so we got a heck of a product out there. But anyway, let's talk about the SMART train. I was not ever a big proponent of the smart trade, but the fact is, it's here, and we need to make it work. And I'll be part of making it work. At the most, it'll be two cars. So the two cars are not going to straddle either 4th or 5th Street while they're coming in. They'll come in, the gate will go down, they'll pass 5th Street, and then they'll pass 4th, and then they'll be into the station. That should not cause any traffic delays in downtown Santa Fe. Should it go to Larkspur? It's going to go to Larkspur, whether we like it or not, it's coming to Larkspur, so we need to make that work also. I'll be part of making that work. And the city of Larkspur needs to have a big say in how that's going to work. And we just can't say, no, it's not going to work. We need to be part of making it work, and I'm committed to doing that. They've spent an awful lot of money on smart, and to just chuck it makes no sense at all. And so hopefully this is going to work for us. And with the right elected officials up there, we're going to make it work for the county and for the ridership. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next one is going to be a pop quiz. Oh, okay. Sorry, go ahead.
I have a question, because I've been noticing the notion of transit-oriented development seems to be evil. I want to kind of turn it around a little bit. I'd like to know what each of the candidates have done in their recent history in office and what they aspire to do to address the runaway cost of housing in our community and the loss of its economic diversity and income diversity. I want to know what your vision is for people who make less than six figures to be able to move and live here and raise a family.
Who wants to go first?
He was looking at me.
Okay. That's because you have a tie on.
That's because I'm wearing a tie. I wish I wasn't wearing a tie. That's all right. So should I start?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
First of all, there's actually two questions there. One was the legitimacy of the concept of transit-oriented development as it applies to Marin County. And then the second question is, how do we facilitate access to affordable housing within our community? So those are actually two separate questions. The concept of transit-oriented development is a concept that was developed in the context of legislation that was adopted a couple years ago in AB 375, which is state legislation that encourages and requires, actually, communities throughout the state of California to adopt a sustainable communities plans. And transit-oriented development is specifically encouraged as part of that. The whole purpose of that strategy was to address climate change issues. The whole purpose of transit-oriented development, as it is embodied in AB 375 and other state bills, is to address that issue. So the question is, within the framework of Marin County, does transit-oriented development really make sense as a climate change strategy? The answer to that is it doesn't. In fact, our own county climate change plan, which Supervisor Ray's advice has endorsed, actually ascribes only a very, very limited benefit associated with transit-oriented development in terms of its impact on climate change. Very, very minimal. I mentioned a minute ago, the biggest thing that we can do in order to address climate change within our community is to support the dispersion of renewable energy resources to every household and every commercial operation within the county. That's what we need to do to address climate change. So transit-oriented development will not accomplish that. It won't do it at all. So on the affordable housing issue, we do need to have more affordable housing with Marin. That is absolutely true. That's a tremendous challenge for us to accomplish, given the demographics and the geography of the community in which we live. But there are things that we can do, and I have supported strategies as a member of the Larkspur City Council within our community to accomplish those goals. We do not need to build high-density, stack-and-pack development along the Highway 101 corridor in order to generate realistic, affordable housing opportunities for people that we need to support. I had a question a week or so ago at a similar candidate event. How do we generate opportunities for affordable housing for firefighters and police officers who want to live in our community communities and support our public safety needs. Those folks don't need small apartments in large apartment buildings. They need homes. They want to live here in the ways in which we all have had the opportunity to live here themselves, in houses, in developments that are affordable and that make sense. We've had the opportunity in Lawrenceburg to encourage that kind of development, and I will continue to encourage that in ways that are respectful of the character of our community and not transforming our community in something that's like we have in Mountain View that is different from what we all moved to when we came to Marin in the first place.
Thank you. I want to tell the questioner that when I was on the council at our little city, the feds would come to me each year and say, you know, you got to come up with 14 units that are affordable housing. So the pressure is on. There is actually considerable pressure from the federal people to have each city come up with affordable housing. And I won't tell you how we solved the problem in Ross, but it was a genius of an idea. It was my idea.
Yeah. I was curious. I appreciate that. I was interested in hearing from the other candidates.
Yeah, don't worry. I'm going to let us get it.
We have all nine.
No, we don't. We have a half hour left. I won't get into this yet. Katie, what do you have to say?
Frank didn't need to speak.
Excuse me?
Frank issue.
Frank's new.
It's Frank's turn.
Frank, okay.
So today we look back at the homes we bought years ago, and many of us say we couldn't afford to buy our own home that we live in today. We couldn't afford to buy it. What's happening is Silicon Valley and the jobs are impacting San Francisco. The tech jobs in San Francisco are impacting Marin. Folks are leaving San Francisco in droves and looking for more affordable housing. They're coming to Marin. So there's huge pressures being put on us. Fairfax is one of the most affordable communities in Marin County. And it's that because we look out for affordable housing over there, up there in Fairfax. So the town banned the conversion of apartment buildings to condominiums. And so we have all of our apartment rental housing stock. The rents are up, sure, but we do have rentals available. When the 70-unit low-income Bennett house was bogged down with a zoning issue, I was mayor, and I helped facilitate that. Fairfax facilitated 70 units of housing for low-income disabled people. I found the solution and it worked, and the community bought into it and said it's right. And today the Bennett House is just a shining example of what you can do in the community for low-income housing without adversely impacting views and traffic, sir. So it's really doable. And so we need a board of supervisors that's committed to real affordable housing. You know, if we're going to have some multi-unit housing, then a large percentage of it has to be inclusionary for affordable rents. And I don't mean 10%, I mean getting up close to 50%. The token 10% affordable housing, like they provided down at the Wind Cup, is ridiculous. They built about 180 units and gave 18 as affordable. I mean, that's crazy. And I imagine if they had to provide 50% affordable housing, they probably wouldn't have built them down there. But I'm not sure what's going on down at Wind Cup, because it's still not open. They turned the sites of the building off. Something crazy is going on down there. I'm up here. In Fairfax, we didn't comment on Wind Cup at the time because it wasn't impacting us, but I would imagine the communities around Wind Cup should come in and run it. But there's going to be a housing bubble. And so during the last housing bubble, 2007, I appeared at the Board of Supervisors and I said to the county, we need to be looking at these homes going in foreclosure. The county should be purchasing them, because the prices were down like $300,000 to $400,000 for a home rent. The county should be purchasing them and putting them into an affordable housing pool for families. And no one wanted to pay attention to what I was saying. We could have purchased a lot of single family homes and put them into a pool. But when this next housing bubble comes, we can do some of that.
Great, thank you. Thank you for finishing on time. Your turn.
So one of the downsides of that visionary plan that we were talking about earlier today, the first countywide plan that was entitled Can the Last Place Last, was that it actually set us on a trajectory for what we're experiencing today, which is housing prices that are going through the roof. We managed to control growth. We've managed to control growth. Slowest growing county and slowest growing cities in the entire Bay Area, and that means supply and demand drive prices up. There was 2 million people living in the Bay Area when the countywide plan 72 was adopted. There's now 7 million people living in the Bay Area. So that's what's driving our prices up, and I don't think that we are not going to build our way into affordability. So I think, and we're not going to, we don't have the land, we don't have the desire, I think, to overturn the zoning that's in place. Nor do I think it's something that as a community we want to do is build our way into affordability. That said, I think as communities, as cities and towns, as the county of Marin, we need to do a better job trying to preserve what housing is affordable today, de-restrict it to the degree that we can, whether that's through acquisition and preservation and conversion to de-restricted in partnership. The county just did a project like that with EAH. Their housing managers, affordable housing managers, and with the Community Foundation, that's one way to try to preserve some of our affordability. And then we also have to look at ways to sort of add to the housing stock within the existing built environment, either through second units or junior second units. But as Kevin, you know, mentioned, clearly that's not a solution for a family, but it may be a solution for a single starting out teacher or a senior who's wanting to downsize. So bottom line, I think that we as a community are going to really be struggling to bring in the workforce that we need to support us in our livelihoods, whether they're retail workers or folks who are working, doing in-home health care for our elderly and or our teachers. And we need to try to do what we can to preserve some mix of housing so that we can help sustain our communities, as every community should be, with a mix of housing and a mix of people being able to live here. But it's going to be a struggle.
That gets the award for the briefest of the three answers.
Thank you.
It was good. So what I'm going to do now is lighten things up a little bit and give questions that need only three sentences to answer. So it's like a pop quiz. Frank, you're going to go first.
Great.
What is your position on Measure AA? First of all, what is AA? Anybody know? It's 12 bucks a year and a new bureaucracy.
It's the first regional parcel tax I think we've ever had here in the Bay Area.
It's nine Bay Area counties. What's your view?
What's my view? I don't think it matters, but it's $12 a parcel that goes to the San Francisco Restoration Authority to do wetlands restoration and flood control and things like that.
Okay, so Frank, do all the candidates know about AA?
Sure.
Okay.
So I'm supporting
three sentences.
I'm supporting the $12 tax. Sea level rise is impacting the Ross Valley Sanitary District, where I serve as a director today. Our sewer pipes are underwater in locations, and we're sucking bay water in and pumping it to central sanitation agency and treating it, and it goes back into the bay, and it's going around and around. Same thing again, but yes, I support it. Sea level rise is with us, we've got to deal with it, we've got to protect our wetlands and resources.
Kevin?
That was more than three sentences.
That's
okay. That's all right.
I'm glad he's young.
Can I have an extra 30 seconds because some of the other candidates have had that? I just want to respond to one thing that Supervisor Rice said about the restrictions a moment ago. That is not a strategy that is appropriate for Marin County. I spent 2 years living in Houston, Texas, where the strategy of controlling growth within that community was to use deep restrictions. And we have the city of Houston is the epitome of sprawl. That is not what we want in Marin County. On this specific question, and I will limit myself to three consensus. I am opposed to Measure AA. I am opposed to regional forces that are trying to control local land use determinations. I am supportive of the impulse to deal with climate change, and I have been an active and vocal proponent of local strategies to deal with climate change within the and sea level rise within the framework of our local community, but not to have it hijacked by the economic interests of other communities throughout the Bay Area. Close enough.
Those are long sentences.
Well, Frank did that, so I felt I could.
But you can do better than Frank.
I am supportive of the Measure AA. I believe it's important for its bay restoration, reclamation properties. For the, I think it's important because of what it can do with regards to making a difference with regards to climate change. Carbon sequestration is something that marshland and rehabilitated fill has the potential to help us with regards to greenhouse gas emissions. And then also perch properties and the potential it has to help us mitigate sea level rise.
Okay, I have another.
See, none of us can follow your rules here. So.
Go ahead. Now, I have another pop quiz. This, I have actually three questions on the lights at Marin Catholic. And I think two sentences, yes or no, pro, con, would be good enough. You're first.
I am not supportive of the proposal that the Marin Catholic brought forward several months ago in an application that has yet to be deemed complete or accepted by the county. And I look to see if and what proposal they will bring forward in the coming months.
Kevin.
I am skeptical about that proposal for a variety of different reasons. But most of all, I don't think that it has been subject to the required scrutiny under the California Environmental Quality Act. It will require to go through in order to evaluate the traffic, the parking, and the environmental impacts associated with Corbin Derrick Creek and wetlands associated with Corbin Derrick Creek back behind that stadium proposal. So I'm happy to see the proposal go forward, but I am skeptical that the environmental impacts can be adequately addressed.
Interesting. Marin Catholic is a huge sports high school. One of their former quarterbacks was just the first person in the National Football League draft, former quarterback from Marin Catholic High School, was selected by the Los Angeles Rams. So you know, they've been involved in sports forever. When I first heard of the application, I thought maybe six, half a dozen night games a year wouldn't be bad at all. Then I saw they wanted over 500 night events, and there's only 365 days in a year. I don't know how they events in our time. So you know, if they want to talk about maybe six high school games a year for nighttime, that might be okay. 500, no.
I got a lot of questions about mental health. I don't think it's fair to ask the supervisors about that.
Well, not all of us are on the board.
Okay. No, it's not pro or con. It's what are you going to do about it? And the answer is you have no idea. It's always been a question. So let's talk about more water. What about what is your opinion of the county's Army Corps of Engineers plan for Port of Madeira Creek from San Anselmo to Ross, where it's not going to happen, to the rest of the creek? Whose turn is it? I've forgotten. I think you're up. Is it Frank?
Sorry,
you missed all my jokes?
Yeah, we missed them.
Thank God.
Hey, you said that. You're out.
I'll hold on.
So the question is, what is your opinion of the county's Army Corps and Army Corps of Engineers plans for Corbin Derrick Creek, which goes from San Anselmo to Ross to the bridge at College of Marin?
Okay, just to clarify, the Corps of Engineers project is from Ross down basically to
San Anselmo, I think, too, isn't it?
Not the Corps. The Corps won't go up that far.
I thought they were like
border of San Anselmo.
Are they talking about retention bases and fair?
No, that's the county. So the detention basin projects, those are county proposals. So what I think you're talking about is the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers project for what's called Unit 4. And Unit 4 is limited to Corbin Air Creek from the fish ladder up by post office in Ross. I'm not sure exactly where it ends, but it ends kind of close to getting the Concord Jail. So your question specifically, and I don't know whether this is a two-sentence answer or a 10-sentence answer, but your question is, what do I think about the plan? The problem that I have responding to that question is, there is no plan. And in fact, that was very evident in the series of meetings we've gone through over the last couple of months, sponsored by the county, sponsored by Supervisor Rice and Congressman Jared Huffman, we just had one week or so ago, where they were trying to articulate what the plan was, but they haven't really disclosed what that plan is. And one of the challenges that I think our community has found is, since we don't know what the plan is, we can't really comment on it. And in fact, the Corps of Engineers and the county, on December 23rd, issued a formal notice of intent, a notice of preparation for environmental review documents under the Federal National Environmental Policy Act and the California Environmental Quality Act, where they said, we are going to initiate an environmental review process for a project for Unit 4. But all they said about the project was, well, we're going to do something, and it's going to help flood control. They never articulated what the project is. It's only in the last meeting that the county and the Corps had, where in a PowerPoint presentation, they started to define a series of berms and other engineered solutions that they are putting out there for the public as a way, essentially a way for the public to provide comment on something. But they have not given us a project. That is not legal, that is not consistent with the requirements of the regulations that have been adopted by the federal government under NEPA, and not compliant with the requirements that have been developed by the state of California under CEQA to define what the project is. We are being shortchanged by both the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and by the county in defining what that project is. It's a travesty and we shouldn't tolerate it.
Thank you very much.
Okay, back in the 60s, the kids used to water ski right out here at College of Rins football field, if anybody remembers that. Put boats in with an outboard motor and water skied. It happened almost every year that there was a flood statue. Then the Corps of Engineers decided they would save us by putting in the concrete ditch here, and that concrete ditch caused as many flooding problems as it solved. You know, it solved some flooding issues, but it created other flooding issues. Didn't work. The engineers completely underestimated the amount of water that's going to come out of the upper Ross Valley and come through here. So unfortunately, that concrete ditch doesn't do what they thought it was going to do. We should have been dredging the lower creek here from the edge of the concrete ditch all the way down to the bridge of Monte Road. That should be dredged regularly, and it's not being done. As far as what their current plan is, as soon as we know their current plan, then we'll be able to really address it. No doubt we want to address the flooding issue, but what's happening now is Kentfield's flooding because the water that's coming out of the hills and coming down the surface streets can't get to the creek because that concrete ditch is blocking it. So we've got a lot of work to do here to protect the Lower Ross Valley, and hopefully once we see the plan, we'll be able to get a result.
Thank you.
And I'm really happy and pleased for our community, specifically for Ross and Kentfield, to be able to finally have an opportunity to try to fix the existing Army Corps project, make it work better than it currently works, remove that fish ladder, and then make some improvements upstream within the parameters of the Unit 4 stretch of the creek towards trying to reduce some of the flooding that's happened in Ross and in Kentfield. The project's owned by the Army Corps. It requires the participation of the Army Corps. We couldn't look at trying to remove that. We can't remove that fish ladder or make fixes within that stretch of the creek without the Army Corps' participation. And finally, after many, many, many years, they have actually allowed us to look at it again. So there is not a project and a plan design yet, because that's the process that's just started. And I hope that many of you will be involved in those meetings and involved in the process, see what we can come up with the engineers, with the hydrologists, and then the community can decide if they would like to implement any or all of what is proposed. And it will go through the CEQA, the environmental process, the federal environmental process as well. So I think it's a great opportunity.
Thank you. I'm getting bored asking the questions. Anybody who have a question?
Well, we're having fun. We're just warming up.
I'll warm up.
You mentioned the feds, and I'd like to get the reaction to each of the representatives ahead of us on whether or not you feel fair housing is a legitimate concern in Marin, and whether or not socioeconomic diversity, as directed by this gentleman, should be a goal of public policy in Marin, and whether you should have it as a priority.
So, shall we combine them to the three sentences, or
yes? Do they? Do you support fair housing?
Yeah.
Do you support economic?
Well, I mean, you, I got that.
Oh, fine, do it. Okay. Good luck.
I do support fair housing, and I tried to say in my answer the last go-round with regards to the importance of our communities and the local government, the cities, towns, and the counties taking some responsibility for being a part of trying to preserve some level of socioeconomic diversity in our communities. I think that's what makes for healthy communities. I just don't know how much we're going to be able to achieve, but we better be trying to do something, and I think that government does have a responsibility, and our and the broader community as well, to try to do the same.
Thank you.
Of course I support fair housing. Fair housing is the law of the land. That is legislation that has been built into our structure of government for years now. The challenge that we have is how that is implemented within communities like we have in Marin County. The County Board of Supervisors entered into an agreement with HUD 5 years ago, which is now expired, where they essentially adopted a strategy to apply statistical analyses to overturn zoning determinations of our local communities. That has now been incorporated into a regulation that the federal government is now in the process of implementing. There are serious constitutional concerns associated with that. I have written on that subject at least twice, I believe. And it's important for us to make sure that as we implement the requirements of federal law to encourage fair housing, we do it in a constitutional way that does not undermine local zoning authority. And that's, I worry, the challenge that we face with the regulations.
Thank you.
Right. It's unfortunate that the federal government ended financing affordable housing projects. They've gotten out of that business. And so the answer is yes, I support fair housing. And I would take a step further. There's more to the issue about affordability. There's living wages. And if folks working here in Marin aren't making living wages, I don't see how they can rent anywhere here in Marin. I've been long supporting a $15 an hour minimum wage now. Not 6 years from now, as the governor's legislation has just outlined, but we need $15 an hour minimum wage now for our low-wage workers. They can't wait 6 years to be able to have a somewhat of a decent wage to try to live here in the Marin apartment. So my answer is yes, and I just took a step.
Thank you. Thank you. Now we have some questions that are nasty questions. I've been saving them to the end here. I think everybody has one. Actually, you're first, Frank.
Great.
One question was, what do you think of natural pesticides? And I think that the questioner was asking about things like Bacilla BT, the stuff that's been around for 50 years and is in 80% of the corn. They've actually done a GMO DNA replacement number on corn so that all corn makes its own pesticide of BT. And the other part of that question is, so if you don't use pesticides on the watershed land, how are you going to control the broom?
Great. Bruce. So.
Yeah. You have 3 minutes. This is a tough question.
So I am definitely no pesticide use on public comments of Marin County properties, period. We talk about BTIs. One of the problems with pesticides, or all pesticides, is we are told what the active ingredients are. That's maybe 6 to 8% of the ingredients in that pesticide. 92%, or maybe 94% of the pesticide is called an inert or unknown ingredient. And no public agency should be spraying any pesticides on public land if they don't even know what's in that pesticide. The producers of the pesticide, be it Monsanto or whoever, they claim that it's a trade secret, that they cannot reveal the contents of the pesticides. I say malarkey. I sit on the Marin Sonoma Mosquito Vector Control District Board. I kind of feel like a double agent there because I'm really concerned about the pesticides we, as a public agency, are spraying. And so I'm constantly trying to find out what the inert ingredients are, and they keep pushing back on me. And we can solve the root problem with handwork. Back in the 80s, some of our communities, the towns, put together a crew that was, they funded the vehicle and then the cost of the correctional officer, and we had inmates from San Quentin on weed patrol and clearing areas. We should probably bring that back and get up there in the watershed and clear out the room by hand. We don't need to use points to do that. Thank you.
So,
did I answer the question?
Since the seeds for the broom last 40 years, are you going to send a crew out every year for 40 years to get rid of
it? You know, even if we sprayed it with pesticides, we'd have to go up there and clean it out anyway. I mean, you just don't go up there and spray and walk away from it. It's not that simple. So the fact is, broom is really overtaken. Both Marin and Sonoma County, I don't know if it's almost become a native plant. And the idea that we're going to eradicate it with pesticides is backward thinking.
Okay. So I don't think the other candidates have to answer that if they don't feel like it.
You're the boss.
Oh, no, we can't.
Boss, oh boy.
We're right.
So the next one's for you.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. This is not
wrong. I know, I'm leaving you out because you didn't say you wanted to say it.
Okay.
And I'm the boss. Did you hear that?
I did hear that.
Okay, that's fine.
Maybe I'll come back and...
I actually haven't got a nasty question for you. I'll see if I can find one. Anyway, for Katie, you talk about transparency. And last year, the Board of Supervisors was sued and lost a case brought against for Brown Act violation. How do you reconcile this?
Reconcile may not be the right word to use. So for those of you who aren't familiar, the Board of Supervisors was sued over an action that I took, I guess. Sitting on the board, I asked for, during open time, or during board member comments, for a staff member from our planning department to come up and provide information around the calendar going forward for around the housing element. We were a series of public meetings were going to be coming up. I had many emails, phone calls, some hysteria the weekend prior and the week before with people sure that there was some imminent decision that was going to be made by the Board of Supervisors around the housing element, and they had not had a chance to participate in the process. So I asked the director of planning to come up during open time, my open time at the Board of Supervisors, to provide the information on the calendar of decision making going forward, the process. My intent was to try to bring information to the public so that to provide some assurance that there was plenty of time, there will be regular agendized meeting around this, or many agendized meetings around this subject. What happened, and I did this knowing past practice of the Board of Supervisors, often staff will comment during the administrator's report or during the Board of Supervisors' comments, but they do so very briefly. And that was the key word. In this instance, the director of planning talked too long. There was some questions and answers that went back and forth between the Board of Supervisors and himself, and that went over the line of what should have been allowed during that time. And so the board and I was called on that, and judge ruled in favor of the folks who brought the lawsuit, or the suit, or whatever legal action it was against us. And the judge, in his decision, you know, reprimanded us and said that the board was in error here, but he also, in his ruling, did say that he believes that the intent of the action, the wrong, was to provide information, transparency, and inform the public.
This was a Marin County judge, or?
Yes.
Which judge?
I don't remember.
Churness.
Yes, sir.
Churness.
Yeah, I have a question.
Okay.
It's about the stream conservation area, about salmon. I don't know what to do about it, but I was very active a few years ago, just to go and listen to the hearings. So first I would like to ask, what's your opinion about it, what's your view about it? But I also would like to ask a more important question. What happened then is that the supervisor from our district voted against the interest of our district and in favor of interest of people from another district. And I found it very disturbing. Not particularly for Ms. Rice, but in general, the structure of the Marin County is such that there are supervisors and things that are very important for our district are actually being decided by supervisors from other districts and vice versa. So that's the other question I have, if it's understood. But the first one is about what's your view and the conflict of interest that was with the salmon thing is that we don't have streams and we hardly have salmon. And to take care of the salmon in San Jeronimo, yeah, we had to limit our rights to use our land. And we had
to limit. That was Spawn, right? Those guys?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And then they were going to pass a law saying that if you were anywhere near a stream, you couldn't sneeze or would disturb the salmon.
Yeah. So, for example, if I want to enlarge my house because I have kids, and I cannot do it.
You can't enlarge the house because you'll encroach on the stream.
Because they care for their salmon.
Right.
And I appreciate salmon. But we have kids too. So the thing is that the regulation was going to cover all the areas, including us, which we are not incorporated, unfortunately, we can't do. So Ross didn't care about it. But
that's not true.
It wouldn't cover Ross. It wouldn't apply to Ross. So these are my questions. But the conflict of interest.
So the question for the candidates is, what do you think of the structure that allows our supervisor, our district, to vote on
okay, so
salmon?
My question is, let's put it like ABC, okay? Number one, I would like to vote to somebody who would be against this regulation, if it's still.
So you wonder who that would be?
I'm sorry?
Who that would be?
I would like to see who that would be, yeah.
That's fair enough.
And number two, I would like a supervisor who votes, or actually voted, for it when it was against our interest.
And which supervisor was that?
And Ms. Rice.
Okay, so
yeah. We talked to her at the time, and she was not helpful at all. As if she did.
Ah, but now the pressure's on. She has
yeah. to yeah. Now I can testify.
Okay,
it's
Mimi's car.
Number three. Number three.
No, we're only going to do one question.
Do you think there's a way to solve the problem of conflict of interest between the district and the supervisors are from other districts deciding for us?
Right. I get it. Okay. First, I think I'm going to let Kevin give a 1 minute response because I know he's an attorney and he has views on legal actions such as Ms. Rice described, just for a minute. And then we'll come back to you and let you answer his question, I guess.
Okay, well,
and then we'll have closing statements.
Okay, I'll do my best. First of all, I have taken the opportunity to respond to Supervisor Rice's characterization of what happened with the litigation on their compliance with Brown Act. That was not a simple reprimand against the board supervisors and the conduct that they engaged in disregarding some of the most fundamental requirements of the Brown Act in terms of public notice, placing things on the agenda, allowing the public to have a legitimate opportunity to actually address issues before the board at a particular meeting. The judge in that case did not just reprimand. The judge thought that the conduct of the county board supervisors in engaged in that process was so egregious that an injunction would be required to require them as a court order to go forward and not continue to violate the Brown Act requirements as a matter of course, because they basically demonstrated their unwillingness to take those requirements seriously. So I really have to take issue with characterization. That was just a simple oversight. It was actually a reflection in the judge's mind of a pattern and practice of irresponsible and frankly illegal behavior in compliance with California's most important fundamental government sunshine law, which is the Brown Act. I'll kind of bypass Mr. Egger's comments when we talk about the pesticide issue the other minute about basically reintroducing chain gangs into our community to deal with our invasive species. So to your question, and I'm not going to get into all of the legal issues with spawn, there was a court decision in that case and imposed certain requirements. Those requirements are in fact what the law requires. But your basic question, I think, has to do with the role of the Board of Supervisors and the role of the supervisor in District 2 relative to the supervisors in the other districts within the county overall. My perspective on that is this. Yes, we are running for the District 2 supervisor position. And it is by virtue of the fact that we are elected officials, that we have a mandate, we are elected to respect and carry forward the interests of the people that are actually voting for us. It is our first and foremost obligation to the voters of this community to take care of their interests. That said, this is a county. We have a secondary but almost equally important obligation to everyone who lives in Marin County to take our county's interests seriously, to promote concerns with respect to that issue or any other issue on a countywide basis. I think it's kind of strange that we have a system of government here in Marin County, and it's all over the place in California, where we divide up these responsibilities in ways that don't allow us to engage in this district on what's happening in West Marin, what's happening in North Marin, bifurcate or whatever, carve these responsibilities up. Doesn't make any sense. We live in a community where we all have to take into account the needs and interests of everyone who lives in Marin County. I am a Marin County person first and foremost, and if I am elected to this position, that will be my priority. First, to respect the interests of the people who will vote for me in this election, but equally important is to respect the needs and interests of everyone in Marin County, because this is the best gosh darn county in the state of California, and we need to do a better job in protecting the needs and interests of people who live here.
Well, I think since the incumbent is here and she's the best looking one, we ought to let her do the first closing statement.
Oh, I resent that.
Excuse me, I've been raising my hand.
I'm sorry, you're too short.
I know. This is about public safety issue. Given there have been several college campuses, and this is one of them, and school tragedies involving people with untreated severe mental illness, i.e. Virginia Tech, Newtown, recently Santa Barbara. If elected, what would you do different than now to help these people get treatment before a tragedy occurs on our campus?
By tragedy, you mean the guys who take the guns and shoot everybody they see?
Yes.
That kind of tragedy?
Yeah, people who, you know, and they're not homeless, that's the thing. They're actually some of these people in their mind, if you read the stories and follow up, they've been home developing arsenal and whatnot. So what would you do?
I think I'm gonna let the candidates make their final statement, but I'm gonna encourage you to come up and talk to the candidates after they make their statement so we can have time. Thank you for your question.
I will say that I do support the Board's law since I see your t-shirt, and I want to make sure that I'm on the record as I have been in the past year.
So Ms. Rice, can you go ahead?
Yeah, I think that I'm not gonna actually make a long-winded closing statement. I think I just want to say thank you again to the organizations that hosted this and to all of you who came here this evening, to all of you who I have worked with over the past many years on a variety of issues. I truly, actually, hard to believe, do love this job, and I have appreciated the confidence and the residents who live in this community and a collaboration. I think I've actually had quite a few accomplishments over a relatively short time. And I think that my reputation as somebody who not only works well with the community but does get things done is demonstrated by a very long, broad, and deep endorsement list. And that's there because folks respect me and trust me. And I hope that you all, each and every one of you, if you've not made up your mind yet about who you're going to vote for, will consider me when you go to deliberate on which box to check. So thanks again for having us here this evening, and I can't wait to go home and have a glass of wine.
Greg, are you going to let you go?
Oh, I hope it's Casadero.
Maybe or maybe not.
So you need a supervisor who's going to represent you. What is accessible? My reputation as an elected official here in the Ross Valley for the past 45 years or so is one of the most accessible. You can reach me anytime, day or night. I will be representing the management staff at the Civic Center. They will drive the second district agenda. I will be representing the consultants to the Civic Center. They will be driving the second district agenda. It'll be you. Your needs and your concerns. You know, too much business, public business, occurs in closed sessions. It happens all the time in almost every public agency that I've ever been associated with. There's nothing new around here. In fact, your Ross Valley Senator District Board, of which I am your elected representative right now, met in some closed sessions over an issue that I brought before the board. On the 10-acre parcel that we own at Larchville Landing, we all own at Larchville Landing, it's contaminated with PCBs. And it turns out those PCBs were manufactured by Monsanto, and Monsanto's had some liability for the cleanup of that site. That's a brownfield site. In closed session, I asked our board to file a lawsuit against Monsanto to have them pay for the cleanup. Duke could run $5 million. The taxpayers have already spent over $6 million on that land, and it needs another $5 million in cleanup. And there was a 3-1 vote against Duke. Now, I'm not supposed to tell you that. But the fact is, I'm filing complaints over this action. The public have no idea. You have no idea that it's a contaminated site. You had no idea Monsanto contaminated the site. And you had no idea your board decided not to go after Monsanto. So,
Let me finish.
So, who endorses Frank Dacre? The Sierra Club, the California Nurses Association, former Marin State Senator Noreen Evans, Marin Water Board member Larry Bragman, Ginger Sudis Mason from Pesticide Free Zone, Marty Griffin, the author of Saving the Marin Sonoma Coast, Sandy Ross of Health and Habitat, Todd Steiner from Swan. A wide array of folks support me because they'll know I'll do a good job for them. If you want someone who's going to be your representative, Frank Akers is one. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Greg.
What can I say? What I can say, first of all, is to thank you all for coming. I appreciate you all taking the time to hear all three of us talk about our vision for our community, talking about the issues that are important to each and every one of us in this community. And I know you share our collective interests in making Marin County a better place. There is one thing that distinguishes me relative to the other candidates who are up here. I have spent my life, my professional life, not as a member of the established Marin political group. I have worked in private practice as a lawyer for 35 years. I'm very proud of the practice that I have had in that capacity. I'm an environmental lawyer. I've worked on a wide range of environmental cases. And I appreciate Frank pointedly bringing up Monsanto because I know that there's been some press there's been some reports in the press about involvement that I've had in certain cases in which Monsanto has been involved. I have never represented Monsanto, although I know that there are people in the community that want to create that by implication and innuendo. It's just false. I've never represented them. I never will. I am very proud of my professional life. I am with a law firm and have been with a law firm as a senior managing partner of my firm in San Francisco, a firm where my colleagues have represented the state of Alaska in its natural resource damages claims against Exxon Corporation for the Exxon Valdez disaster. I am a member of a law firm where my colleagues have represented the Attorney General's Office of the state of Louisiana in claims arising out of the Deepwater Horizon. We are committed environmental lawyers. I am a committed environmental lawyer. I want to bring my perspectives on the environment to the role of the Marin County Board of Supervisors. I am very grateful that I have been endorsed by the Sierra Club. I am very grateful that I have been endorsed by the Citizens for Sustainable Pension Plans. I'm very grateful that I have been endorsed by a wide range of individuals, citizens, public officials throughout this community. I think I actually have the credentials, the capabilities, the skills, the desire, and the love for this community that is required to be a successful supervisor in this county. And I really would appreciate your support going forward in that election. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think we should give the candidates